Sambhaya Chakshurum Vilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Nama Gurave Guru Chandaya Radhikaya Pudalaya Krishnaya Krishna Bhaktaya Tadabhaktaya Namo Namo Yam Pravrajanta Manupetam Apeta Krityam Dvaipayano Viraka Taruvadyuhava Utreti Tanmayataya Tarabho Vindus Tansarva Bhutamidayam Muni Manatosmi Bhaktya Vihina Shri Shriman, Srila Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada, and the same unlimited obeisances in the dust of the lotus feet of my most worshipful Shiksha Gurudev, Nityalila Pravishta Om Vishnupad, Astotra Sat Shri Shriman, Srila Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, to Srila Bhakti Vidyan Bharati Goswami Maharaj, to all of our Guru Bhakt, our disciplic succession of self-realized souls, and to all the assembled devotees. So welcome to this final class of Sri Bhajan Rahasya. Excuse me, do you speak English or Russian?
Russian.
Russian, okay. Snigdha is doing a you met her already? Does he know how to get your translation on the...
He has radio too.
Radio, you can show him how to use the radio?
Yes. What's the Russian?
So this is the eighth and final class of the course on Sri Bhajan Rahasya, in which Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, our most merciful seventh Goswami, brings us from the beginning till the final stages of bhakti. We discussed from the first chapter the stages of associating with pure devotees, life after life, in small, unknowing ways, and picking up impressions in the heart from spiritual pious activities for millions of births to finally get the serious association of pure devotees, at which time these stages, subsequent stages of bhakti begin to develop. From Shraddha, which is the conviction that by serving Krishna, all other subsidiary activities are performed without any endeavor. to Anartha Nivritti in the performance of bhajan, or the 64 limbs of bhakti, the 9 limbs of bhakti. Gradually anarthas begin to subside. Inauspicious qualities like lust, greed, anger, pride, illusion, envy begin to subside. One comes to the stage of nistha, firm faith, then ruchi, some taste, to the stage of asakti, when these true sentiments of the soul begin to manifest as a semblance form, as our spiritual body, by semblance, begins to manifest in our heart. And now we're coming to the stage of bhava bhakti, which is the 6th stage of bhakti, and which corresponds to the 6th verse of Shikshastikam, which is the first verse of the 6th chapter. And then we also sang Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's expanded understanding of that 6th verse in his own song based on that 6th verse. So we're going to read that first verse of the 6th chapter. Nayanam galadashudaraya padanam gadgarudaya gira ulakayam ichitam babuhakaya dharamalamayavishvati. O Lord, when will tears flow from my eyes, my voice falter, and all the hairs of my body stand and end as I chant your holy name? Now the bhajan of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, which we sang some minutes ago, is a summary of this 6th chapter, which is based on that verse, when will tears flow from my eyes, and so on. So I'll read that translation as well. Due to my offenses, the fruit of my offenses, aparada phale, my heart has become hard like a bolt of lightning and feels no transformation from chanting your name. The holy name of Krishna is all-powerful, just like Krishna himself, all-merciful. So if, while chanting, and it gives all perfection, all the stages of bhakti, all the way up to praying, so if one is not experiencing the bodily transformations that come along with the stage that we'll be discussing today, bhava bhakti, that is bodily symptoms, emotional symptoms, then it's understood that this chanter is full with offenses. So now Bhaktivinoda Thakur is taking the role of us who's full with offenses and saying, because of my offenses over so many births, my heart has become hard like a thunderbolt, like a bolt of lightning, and thus my heart feels no transformation from chanting your holy name. So downcast, O Hari, I cry out your name again and again in great distress, like, when will these symptoms come? Gurudev said the main word in our vocabulary is when. Kabhi habhi, when, oh when, will that fortunate occurrence happen to me? O you who are merciful to the fallen, O root cause of compassion, please give me a drop of the ocean of bhav and save my life. We find this in the many songs and prayers of Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Rupa Goswami, Not that, oh, I'm so fallen. How can I possibly ask Krishna for the highest thing when I'm in the lowest place? I don't deserve it, so I won't pray for it. But our acharyas like Bhaktivinoda Thakur are teaching, although I'm offensive, I have no taste for the holy name, again and again I'm chanting in great distress, please give me, even though I don't deserve it, yes, no problem, but even though I don't deserve it, please give me those symptoms of Bhav. We've been discussing the gradual development of intensity of humility and lamentation, which was already extreme in asakti, as we discussed yesterday, natural attraction and affection for bhajan and the object of bhajan, the Lord. But that extreme doesn't compare with the extreme of humility and lamentation of bhava bhakti, as we'll be discussing throughout today. When will tears flow continuously from my eyes upon uttering your holy name? My throat then choked, only stuttered half syllables will issue from my mouth. My whole body will be covered with goosebumps, and I shall perspire, tremble, and become stunned again and again. Throughout this sixth chapter, these symptoms, called astasattvika bhavs, the eight bodily manifestations of bhav or mood, will be described more elaborately in Srila Gurudev's commentary of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's verses.
Eight bhavs, okay.
I'm sorry?
Eight bhavs.
Eight bodily manifestations of bhava. I'm sorry?
Astasattvik.
Called astasattvik bhavs. Asta means eight, sattvik.
And what about Ksanti Ravyakata?
What? It's coming in like verse 4 or 5 or so. Everything is there in Sri Bhajan Mahasya. Last year, in this Sri Bhajan Academy, we discussed Raghavartma Chandrika. So much of that Raghavartma Chandrika is discussed in this sixth chapter of Sri Bhajan Mahasya. My body becoming pale, I shall lose consciousness and then hold on to my life by taking shelter of your holy name. Bhaktivinoda, who is devoid of intelligence, weeps. O Lord, will I ever encounter such a day? So here, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in the second verse, the first verse of each chapter is always one verse after another of Shikshastakam. And the rest of the verses nourish our understanding of that stage of bhakti and that verse of Shikshastakam. So it's very interesting. We know of the word sattva as general goodness. But here, sattva is explained very, very detailed in relation to bhava bhakti. I'll find that in a bit. Sattva is that stage when spiritual emotions, the real emotions of the soul, begin to manifest. And there are eight outward features of that sattva, those spiritual melting of the heart, which gives rise to transcendental tastes. And that manifests as eight bodily features, which Bhaktivinoda Thakur is going to describe in elaboration. So let's first go, as he describes in text 2, let's go to the definition of Bhava Bhakti. Bhava Bhakti is the first stage of praying, or pure love of God. So there are sattvika bhavs, hair standing on end, tears. We sing in the second verse of Guru Vastikam each day. Romancha kampar sru taranga bhaja vande guru sri charanaravindam. Sri Guru is always experiencing these astasattvic bhavs, although they're not always manifest to us, conditioned soul. Bhav is considered the sprout of the plant of prem. At the time of prem, the creeper of devotion manifests fruits and flowers. At the time of bhav, which is the first stage of prem, that is like the sprout of that plant. And if prem is going to be compared with the sun, then bhava bhakti is the first rays of the arising of that sun.
In bhav, there is already,
I'm sorry, louder?
In bhav, there is already four fruits.
Four?
Leaves.
Leaves.
Right. Namely? Right. As actually what Vrajanath Prabhu said is what Srila Bharati Maharaj was explaining a couple of nights ago, that there are three stages: sadhan bhakti, bhav bhakti, which is actually a sadhan, bhav sadhan, and then prema bhakti. So in each of these consecutive stages, the more and more leaves of the creeper of bhakti unfurl. In Vaidhi bhakti, the leaf is curled closed, and so the outer leaf is prominent. And that outer part of the leaf is very rough, means there's so many obstacles on our path due to our anarthas, four kinds of anarthas that we discussed: offenses, weakness of heart, misconception, attachment to worthless things. And then, as raganuga is developing, as one's coming to the stage of asakti and then bhava bhakti, the inside of the leaves become open. And that inside of the leaves are smooth, very easy, smooth flowing. The obstacles go away due to the arising of intense greed, which burns away all the obstacles. So as Vrajanath Prabhu mentioned, two leaves become unfurled at the stage of Vaidhi Bhakti, and that is...
I'm
sorry?
Sadhana Bhakti.
Yes, Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti. And that is, good qualities come, and the removal of bad qualities also come. Then in this stage above, two more leaves. So there are four leaves open. That is, the subhada, or auspiciousness in his life, is increased further, and the removal of anarthas and lust, anger, greed, pride, illusion, and envy disappear even further. Inauspiciousness goes away more. And there are two other leaves. That is, the devotee realizes the insignificance of impersonal liberation. And what's the other one? Moksha, the idea of liberation becomes insignificant. So dulabha is another quality of bhava bhakti. Su means very, and dulabha means rare. It's very rare to to attain this kind of bhakti that leads to Raja Bhakti and especially Madhurya Bhakti, which is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to give. Specifically, that feature of Madhurya Bhakti, which is the maidservants of Srimati Radhika. I had a choice today to very, very quickly run through the next three chapters, which is Bhava Bhakti, this is chapter 6, then Prema Bhakti has two chapters, Prema Bhakti first in separation and then in meeting. So I had a choice to go like a cyclone through these chapters, but as I was beginning to read the sixth chapter, I could see that it has so much details. Better concentrate on Bhava Bhakti today, and then on your own you can read the chapters in relation to Prema Bhakti. So in Prema Bhakti, the final two leaves of the creeper of bhakti open. One is that such kind of bhakti attracts Krishna. Like Madhavendra Puri, he was simply chanting anybody for any food, fasting if nobody brought him milk, and absorbed in the holy name, and Krishna personally came to him incognito in the form of a coward boy to bring him milk, and then gave him so many instructions on how to worship his deity, how to serve him. So Krishna was attracted to come to him. And the other one is Sandrananda Visheshatma. The Baba, this stage is when one becomes an actual, he feels unlimited pleasure, intense unlimited pleasure, as he becomes a follower of the associates of Krishna and partakes in the pastimes of Krishna, which is controlled by Satchit Ananda, the combination of Satchit and Ananda, eternity, bliss, and knowledge. This being controlled by Satchit Ananda begins at this stage of Bhava Bhakti. That is, Bhava Bhakti is also called Shuddha Sattva Vishesh Atma. Shuddha Sattva means he's beyond the platform of pure goodness. He's on the platform of pure goodness, beyond the material platforms of goodness, passion, and ignorance. And at that time, he's controlled by the Sandini potency, Ladini potency, and Samvit potency of the Lord. That is Satchit and Ananda. The spiritual existence potency, the spiritual knowledge potency, and the spiritual pleasure potency, which is predominated by Ladini, predominated by Srimati Radhika, because she is the embodiment of favorable service to Krishna. So she controls this Bhava Bhakti. There are three different kinds of tastes that come at Bhava Bhakti. And I'd like to mention in relation to Kamala Kanta Prabhu's question yesterday, that if in a ruchi there's taste for the holy name and bhajan, why is it considered in the category of intelligence rather than heart or spiritual emotions? It's because of the degree of taste. Like I have taste for different, like I had a taste when Madhukar Prabhu was singing this song of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. But it was so tiny. It wasn't on the platform of soul. On Asakti, the soul begins to manifest. Our spiritual emotions, the semblance of them, begin to manifest. And we can see the reflection of that soul. In the stage of Bhav Bhakti, the taste becomes immense. In fact, so much so does those tastes become immense that the heart becomes melted by those tastes. And the taste is so extreme that it has a different meaning. Ruchi has a different meaning here. Everything has a different meaning. All the stages have a different meaning. All the symptoms have a different meaning when it's in the next higher stage of bhakti. So here, the word ruchi refers to three things. The desire, number one, the desire to attain Bhagavan. Well, you can say that that desire was there in Shraddha. But in Bhav, it's there in, like at every moment, to its extreme. Like if I don't have this, I'll die. Like Raghunath Das Goswami, who was in the mood of a Bhava Bhakta, was praying to Radharani, if you don't give me your darshan, in the next moment, because I'm now burning up in a great conflagration or forest fire of separation from you, I'm feeling that I will actually literally burn to death in the next moment if I don't receive your mercy. Number two, the desire to do what is favorable for Bhagavan. So we can see how this is, these features are predominated by Ladini Shakti, the Srimati Radhika herself. That Shakti which gives pleasure to Krishna and pleasure to the living entity engaged in his service. And three, the desire to serve Bhagavan with affection, with deep friendship. So what is the natural function of Bhava Bhakti? The natural function is that it manifests Krishna's inherent nature as well as the nature of his pastimes and qualities. And it arises in two ways. One is by the performance, by the very serious performance of sadhan bhakti. And the second way it arises is by the causeless mercy of Krishna or any of his devotees. Some examples of those who attain Bhava Bhakti by the causeless mercy of Krishna and his devotees. Of course, interestingly enough, these examples are examples of eternal associates of the Lord who are playing the part of Bhava Bhaktas. That is, Jagai and Madai are examples. They got the mercy. What sadhana were they doing? The sadhana of trying to kill Brahmanas and loot and steal from everybody. But they got the causeless mercy of Nityananda Prabhu and then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And thus they received Bhav as a result of that benediction. Jiva Goswami also received Bhav as a result of a spurti in his heart. Sukadeva Goswami, what sadhan did he do? He was in the womb of his mother for 11 years, and he came out and ran to the forest, and then his father called him back, and already he was in ecstasy, but his ecstasy was full with renunciation of not caring about anybody, not caring about his father or anybody else. And then when his father called him back, he taught him Srimad Bhagavatam, made him a pure Vaishnava, full with compassion. And then there's a verse about him in the first canto that out of his intense compassion for those who are drowning in the ocean of material existence, my spiritual master, Sri Sukadeva Goswami, spoke that essence of all revealed scriptures, Srimad Bhagavatam. Then, as Brajanath Prabhu asked about the 9 symptoms of Bhava Bhakti, these 9 symptoms, this verse was selected as verse 3 of this 6th chapter. And that verse goes like this. Shantir Bhakta Kali Twam Viraktir Mana Sunyata Ashabandha Samutkanta Namakaya Sadaruchi Ashakti Stadmunakyane Kriti Stadmasati Stale Nityadayo Nubhavahar Syor Bhava Syor Jata Bhavan Kare Jane. Srila Gurudev all around the world discusses these 9 symptoms. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur simply mentions the symptoms because he's quoting the verse. And in Srila Gurudev's commentary on this verse, he elaborates. We're so lucky to have Gurudev as our Gurudev, who elaborates on everything for us. So the first is Shantir. He's tolerant. We read that back in the Najanam, in the stage of Ruchi, one of the features is tolerance. He's tolerant more than a tree. Even if the woodcutter comes to chop down the tree is tolerant. And without desiring any reciprocation, that tree offers its fruits, its flowers, its shade, everything, its bark. But in the stage of Bhava Bhakti, that tolerance goes to the extreme. For example, Parikshit Maharaj was told that he was cursed to die in 7 days by the bite of a snake bird. Dhanavad Maharaj, how are you?
I want to come long ago, people are coming, could not come.
Of course, it's your last day. Right after this, I'll give you the stick.
Okay.
But Parikshit Maharaj, even after hearing that in 7 days he was going to die by a snake bird's bite, he couldn't have cared less. It didn't bother him at all. He was actually happy. He thought, I've offended that Brahmana. This is in our Prabhupada's words. I've offended the Brahmana. His son has cursed me. That's nice. And he immediately took the opportunity to give up any last vestiges of his attachment to his kingdom. And he went to the bank of the Ganges and simply heard Srimad Bhagavatam, very thirsty for all that nectar. Then, second symptom, avyarta kalatva, means that he doesn't waste even a single moment. Like a non-devotee doesn't, quote-unquote, waste any time on Krishna consciousness. And a neophyte, aspiring devotee, in our attempt to attain bhakti, pure bhakti, I personally waste a lot of time. I would say 99% of my time is wasted on idle thoughts. Thoughts that just come, and then I forget what I'm doing. I forget that I'm chanting. I forget that I'm saying my Gayatri. And I forget that I'm hearing Hari Katha. But when somebody comes to the level of Bhava Bhakti, we can't imagine that stage. What the happiness of that stage. He doesn't waste even a fraction of a moment. He was always absorbed in Hari Bhajan, weeping into his songs, into his prayers, that when, oh when, will that come? I'm about to die in the next moment. Rolling on the ground, Raghunath Das Goswami prayed to Srimati Radhika, when will I hear your ankle bells tinkling, and thus my deafness will be cured. As Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, Srila Prabhupada stated, before we get the mercy of Guru, we're simply hearing sounds of deafness. So Raghunath Das Goswami is praying, please cure my deafness by letting me hear the tinkling of your ankle bells. This is Vallabh Kusumanjali. Then Virakti, a natural distaste arises for any enjoyment in this world. Just like if somebody were to give us, this is Gurudev's example, warm, salty Mathura tap water in the middle of the summer, I would have a natural distaste. Then mana sunyata, sunyata zero, he has zero desire for respect. When Vaikhanis Maharaj, when Brajanath Prabhu called on Vaikhanis Maharaj to speak about Srila Prabhupada a few days ago, and then Vaikhanis Maharaj said, no, Shamrani, and I said, no, Vaikhanis Maharaj. It was such a relief for me that he was speaking instead of me, because then at the end of his class, I could be thinking, he said this, he said that, that was so interesting, wow, I never heard that before quite in that way, wow. And if I had given the speech, I would have thought, I wonder if everybody liked it, I wonder if I said that well enough, oh, I missed that point, and the whole thing would have been lost. But as Bhav Bhakti comes, mana sunyata, he has zero, even if he has so many qualifications, beauty, wealth, strength, high birth, he has no desire to enjoy that mentally and no desire to get honor from that. Even if he gets no respect from others, he's always respectful to others. And Ashabandha, he has a great faith, like Shraddha is also there in the higher stages of bhakti, but in a higher way. So he has that faith, Ashabandha, that even though there's no hope for me because I'm so destitute and fallen, with no good qualities at all, and full of anartha, sins and offenses, still, I have that faith that if I'm engaged diligently in bhajan, then Krishna will surely give me his mercy. Steadfast hope. Hoping, even though there's no hope for me, still I'm hoping because I know about Krishna's mercy. Like Rupa Goswami prayed, although I'm a hopeless case, I have hope. Why? Because Krishna gave liberation to the embodiment of sin, Agasura. So there's hope for me. Then, oh, an example that Srila Gurudev gives of hope is the one of the last verses or last verse. One of the last verses of Vilabh Kusumanjali, where Raghunath Das Goswami is praying that today I'm filled with an ocean of hopes that I will receive your mercy, Srimati Radhika. And if I don't get your mercy, then what is the use of my living in Braj? And what is the use of Krishna's mercy? And what is the use of this body? I might as well just commit suicide. This was also there in Srila Narottam Das Thakur, that I have no attraction for Gaura Ras, Gaura Kirtan. What am I living for? I might as well die. What's the use of this body? But still hoping against hope. Ashabandha, filled with extreme hope. And then Samut Kanta. How much hope? So much hope that my throat becomes choked with eagerness. And that eagerness, Gurudev gives the example of Vritrasura. Srila Bharati Maharaj also quoted in the last couple of classes this prayer by Vrishasura. And Gurudev taught it to his companions. They had to memorize those verses after their morning walks. Ajata paksha iva mataram kaga stanyam yata vatsarata chudarta priyam priyeva yusitam vishanna mano ravindaksha dikrikshatetam. First he's thinking, well, maybe I should desire to be like a bird, a little baby bird who's still in the egg, and he's waiting for his mother to come with a worm to feed him. No, that's not going to work, because that's not really praying for my mother. It's praying for the worm. It's going to come from my mother, but it's outside my mother. Well, maybe I should pray like the calf. The calf is bound up by the milkman, and the calf is praying that when will my mother come back from grazing so that she will give me the milk from her udder. That's better than asking for the worm from the mother, because the milk is within the mother, but it's still not pure. It's still wanting something from the mother that she has inside her body. Yes, I know. I'll pray to be like the wife. The wife is waiting for her husband to come home, and he's late. So she becomes filled with worry. Maybe the train derailed. Maybe he had an accident. And she's so worried, waiting for him to come home so that she can serve him and satisfy him in all ways. So similarly, Vrishasura is praying. Like that wife, finally, he decided, I always yearn for the opportunity to render service to you. So then the next symptom of Bhava Bhakti, sometimes Gurudev would call on various devotees to explain each of these stages, so he really wanted us to understand them. Namagane Sadaruchi, always chanting the holy name of the Lord, with great taste. Again, this taste is different from the taste in ruchi, because this taste is the taste of the melted heart giving rise to various ruchis or various tastes. When this intensifies further, so that to the point where there is complete mamata, or a sense of mindness, that is, the heart now is melted in bhav. But when it melts to the extreme stage of melting, that is the stage of praying. And that is the stage where the devotee has mamata, or a sense of possessiveness or mindness. Krishna is my son. Krishna is my friend. Krishna is my beloved. And for us, Krishna is the beloved of my Swamini, and therefore he's my beloved. Who has more? This is a question to the audience. Who has more mamata? Narada Muni or Maharaj Yudhisthira? Yes?
Narada Muni in this form of Manu Mangal and
Trick answer.
Which Narada Muni?
Narada Muni is ultimately, he's an expansion of Madhu Mangal, who has the mamata of friendship with Krishna. So he gave the best answer.
He's also Narada Gopi.
Plus he's Narada Gopi. Mm. But in his form of Narada, he has a relationship of Das with Ram, especially with Narayan. But Yudhisthira Maharaj, he has a relationship of cousin brother. So that's more mamata. So in that regard, he has more. So mamata comes in praying. But in bhav, there's still a melted heart. And there's, bhav is like, Gurudev gave the example of, like that almirah. There's so many books inside, but I can't get to them because of the glass. Is that right, Maharaj? So similarly, I don't yet have my Vastu Siddhi, or my spiritual form. I still have the minor impediment of this gross body. So although my Siddha Deha has, or spiritual form, has manifested in my heart, and I can go deep into meditation, that now I'm Rati Manjari, Raghunath Goswami can think, now I'm Rati Manjari, and I've nudged Krishna with my elbow and grabbed the brush from him as he was painting Radharani's feet with his trembling hand, and I grabbed the brush from him. He was in so much anxiety, but I took the brush anyway, and I began to paint Radharani's feet. So there's deep meditation, but the outside body is still this external body. But in the stage of prem, he has Vastu Siddhi, which means he only has that spiritual body, where he's fully entered into Krishna's pastimes. And so the sense of mamata and melted heart increases and increases and increases to sneha, to pranaya, to man, to so many other ecstatic sentiments towards the Lord as our prema increases. And as my relationship is more high, like for example, in Vatsalya Ras, I think that goes up to sneha, that much affection, wanting to see the Lord at every moment, and a deep melted heart. The coward boys go up to another stage. The gopis go up to another stage, Mahabhav. The more intimate coward boys and Krishna himself can touch Mahabhav. But the gopis, they go higher than that, and the monopoly of Radharani is Madanakya Mahabhav, which is the extreme stage of feeling separation in meeting and meeting in separation. So this is all beginning in this stage of bhav. And namagane sadaruchi, chanting in that way. Then asaktis tad gunakyane. That means they always want to hear and describe the pastimes of Krishna, and they never become satiated. Okay, I heard for 5 minutes the pastimes of Krishna, now let's talk some prajalpa. Did you hear what so-and-so did and about the fall down of so-and-so? I couldn't believe it. So we become easily satiated by hearing the pastimes. And we have so much alternate taste for mundane things. Srila Gurudev explained in Badger that if after my Harikatha you speak about and meditate on what I said, then it will enter into your heart and become yours. If after my Harikatha you speak and think about other topics, then whatever I've said will evaporate in the air. Then tad vasati, the last of the nine symptoms. Tad vasati stale priti. That is, he has a desire to reside in Vrindavan. Srila Gurudev explains here in his commentary that if I'm in the association of a rasik bhakta who's always living in Vrindavan in his heart, then anywhere I am with that pure devotee in the world, that place is Vrindavan. On the other side, living in Vrindavan has real benefit only if I have the association of a pure devotee. Srila Gurudev quotes two songs in this connection. And when I was with Srila Bharti Maharaj last year, I asked that when we're with you in Chandigarh during the month of Karti, when everybody's supposed to be doing Braj Mandal Parikrama, But you're not taking us on Braj Mandir Parikrama. I mean, the most parikrama we get with you is we go around the temple and offer pranam to the deities, to Tulsi, to your Guru Maharaj, but that's a 5-minute thing. So, how do we get our Braj Mandir Parikrama? How is it okay to be with you in the midst of a big city like Chandigarh? Of course, we make sure to go on Braj Mandir Parikrama before or after Kartik. But my question was for during Kartik. So he quoted, Srila Bharati Maharaj quoted, and Srila Gurudev is quoting Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's song in this regard. Gaura Amar Jai Shabastani Karalo Brahmana Range Se Sabastana Heriba Ami Pranayi Bhakata Sangi. In the association of loving devotees, I will go to all the places that Gaura or Varanga joyfully visited. In other words, being with a pure devotee is automatically being, actually being, not association like the insect. Our Prabhupada gives the example that there's two ways to associate. The king has two associates. One is that one servant is always thinking, how can I serve the king? But sitting on the same throne as the king, there's a little mosquito, and he's thinking, where can I find a hole in his clothes so I can bite the king? So real association. I asked Srila Gurudev about my godbrothers back in 1992 or 93. I said, how is it that those godbrothers of mine who had, you know, it looked like the most association with our Prabhupada than anybody, traveling with him and being with him practically at every moment, how is it that most of them have turned against you and are always criticizing you and telling people not to go to you? How is that possible? So Gurudev replied, they were only externally associating with Prabhupada. They weren't trying to associate with him by his inner moods. And so Gurudev said, after Prabhupada left, then their thinking was, what did he do? He went to 49 countries, and I have gone to 52 countries. So by actual association with pure devotees, one is in Vrindavan. And the real benefit of being in Vrindavan is to be under the guidance of pure devotees. Then, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur talks about the astasattvika bhavs and the bodily conditions that result as a manifestation of those inner moods. That is, the astasattvika bhavs, as you've heard, are trembling, pallidity of the color, the complexion becomes paled, tears, horripilation, hair standing on end, becoming stunned, becoming unconscious, devastated. And then there are anubhavs, which are bodily activities that happen. Like, for example, dancing. And what else? What are some other ones besides dancing?
Rolling on the ground.
What else?
Singing.
What else?
Loud crying.
Good. So these are anubhavs. They nourish bibhav. See, I once asked Gurudev in 1992, what's the use of learning all these different terms? Anubhav, bibhav, what is that when there's lots of contradictory emotions?
Vyabhichari bhav,
but kila kinshita bhav. What's the use of like learning all these technical terms. So Gurudev said, there's no use if you're in prema bhakti or bhava bhakti and you're experiencing all the emotions. But if you're before that, if you're an ajata rati sadhak, you have not yet reached the stage of bhava, then you need to know what you want to attain. Also, because you have to attain that, you have to know what it is. Also, if I'm giving a Hare Katha, Gurudev said, and I say, Radha and Krishna were experiencing Kila Kinchita Bhav, what would you know of that? Nothing. So you need to know the meanings of the terms. So what's the meaning of Vibhav? Because it says here that these Anubhavs, crying, rolling, singing, dancing, it's not like our dancing, like, you know, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. But the dancing controls the devotee. He doesn't make the intellectual decision that now I'm going to use my right foot or left foot and now I'm going to jump, as we do on our stage. He's controlled by the Anubhavs, which are external manifestations of these Astasaktikabhavs. And these Anubhavs nourish Bibhav. So what is Bibhav? What are the Bibhavs? Maharaj, what is Bibhav?
Vishesh Rupena Bhava Bibhava.
Good. What does that mean? Isn't there two kinds of...
Yes.
Visaya,
Asraya, then Alamban, Uddipan.
Thank you for all the Sanskrit terms describing the Sanskrit.
And Asraya on so many types, and Uddipan so many types.
Okay, so to translate into English what Madhav Maharaj and Vrajanathapu just said, as the definition for Vibhav, there's two aspects of Vibhav, which is one of the five features of Rus, or relationship with Krishna. You wanted somebody?
No, just the chair.
Both sides.
One side is alamban. Alamban means who's participating in this vibhav or the relationship. And that has two features. The vishaya, or the object of love, and the ashraya, or the reservoir of love. For example, Krishna is the Vishaya and Radha is the Ashraya. Guru is the Ashraya, the embodiment or reservoir or fountain of love, and Krishna is the object of love. And those are the two features of the two that are having relationship. And then the other side is Udipan, which is the stimulus of that love. In different rasas, and in Krishna's different ages, there are different stimuluses called udipans. Like, for example, in Madhurya Ras, in Krishna's teenage, one stimulus may be his flute playing, whereas in another ras, at a younger age of Krishna, the stimulus may be what, Maharaj? What's an example?
When Krishna, for Mother Yashoda, one type of stimulation, for Sakha's different type, for Sakhi's different type.
Right. So Mother Yashoda may see Krishna's little toys. And when Krishna's already in Mathura, he's already left Vrindavan, and she's seeing his little toys, and she bursts out weeping in separation. That stimulated her love. So these are the two features of Vibhav. One is Udipan, or the stimulus, and the other is Alamba, meaning the two persons involved, the object of love and the reservoir of love. Good. So there's, let's see. Then, although back in the fourth chapter, in the stage of Ruchi, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quoted the verse I'm not a Brahmana, I'm not a Kshatriya, I'm not a Vaishya, I'm not Sudra, not interested in gaining the benefits of those varnas or ashramas. My only identification is that I'm a servant of a servant of a servant of Krishna who maintains or serves the gopis. But then, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who quoted that verse back in Ruchi, he's quoting it again at this stage of Bhav, again confirming that all the previous stages of bhakti are present in the subsequent stages, but in a much more developed and intense features.
Mm. Now he has vikyan, you know, he's realizing this.
Now he's realizing. Yeah. But even the realization is becoming more and more extreme. Mm. The realization is there in asati, but it's becoming more extreme in bhav, and then to its fullest. So now, text number six is where Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quotes that verse. I'm not a Brahmana, I'm not a Kshatriya. And in Srila Gurudev's commentary, he says that whatever one, he's quoting the verse from Prem Bhakti Chandrika, that whatever one contemplates in his sadhak form, that he attains in his perfection. This was a point of controversy that Gurudev mentioned in his Gurudev's biography. The devotee was asking in an istagosti, which was headed by Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Goswami Maharaj and our Param Gurudev Srila Bhakti Pragyan Kesava Goswami Maharaj. The question was, this verse is there. Whatever one is thinking of at the time of sadhana, he attains that stage at the time of siddha, perfection. So does that mean that he can choose something in sadhana, like by whatever association he gets, then he does that kind of sadhana and that's the kind of siddha he gets? And our two acharyas gave all kinds of shastric evidence and logical evidence that no, whatever seed is there in his soul, that becomes his sadhana at the time of bhav sadhana. That is, he's experiencing in sadhana, in bhav sadhana, raghaduga sadhana, he's experiencing his relationship. As we mentioned the other day, in bhav bhakti, raghaduga bhakti, there's three stages of consciousness. One is called internal consciousness, where the devotee is forgetful, totally forgetful of his external body. Raghunath Das Goswami is fully absorbed that I am Rati Manjari and I've just grabbed the paintbrush from Krishna and now I'm painting Radha's feet. And Krishna is full with anxiety and what am I doing? I'm laughing at him, that he's in anxiety. Because Radharani hinted at me with her eyes, after all, that I should teach him how to paint. He's a Baal painter, he's a neophyte painter. He doesn't know how to paint. Look at him, he's trembling. And he's making trembling marks on Radharani's feet. So then, as he's just about to paint, what happens? The whole scene disappears. And Raghunath Das Goswami finds himself rolling on the banks of Radhakund, weeping. And where is that scene? And then he comes into fully external consciousness, where he can talk, where he can write, but still he's feeling separation. When will that scene come again? So according to my swarup, my soul, that kind of sadhana in bhava bhakti. It's true that Hridaya Govinda, who was the spiritual master of Duki Krishnadas, he was a coward boy, Subal Saka, perhaps. And so by his association, Duki Krishna Prabhu was getting an inclination towards Sakya Ras. But then, spiritual master was wise, a realized spiritual master. He knew that the swarup of my disciple is Madhurya Ras, he's a Manjari. So he sent him for that kind of association wherein his swarup would develop. He sent him to Srila Jiva Goswami, and he was trained in the sadhan of Manjari Sadhan, and thus he achieved that perfection as Shyamananda. So the only difference between sadhan bhakti then and prema bhakti is that one is unripe and one is ripe. Now the next text that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur decides to quote, the next verse that he decides to quote, is that famous Raghunuga Bhakti quote from Raghavartma Chandrika, which is also quoted in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. And this is a verse of Viswanath Chakravarti Thakur. That's one of the three verses describing a Raghunuga Bhakta. That is, Seva Sadhaka Rupena Siddha Rupena Chakrahi Tadbhava Vipsuna Karya Raja Lokana Sadhaka. He has an intense longing. Seva Sadhaka Rupena. It's not that Seva Sadhaka Rupena. I, in my stage now, which is barely Shraddha, full of anarthas, I don't know where my anartha nivritti, when that will come, but I'm following, to a certain extent, Seva Sadhaka Rupena. I'm thinking, because I'm doing what the Goswamis did. I'm studying the Vedic literatures, I'm following the codice, I'm chanting. So I can do that to a very, very limited extent. My chanting has no relationship with their chanting. My studying scriptures has no relation with their studying scriptures. Still, I can say I'm doing that. But then, Siddha Rupena Chatrihi, how will I follow the six Goswamis in their Manjari forms? Unless I can intellectually, now I'm meditating, that Rati Manjari is just grab the brush from Krishna, and I can even go to an extreme stage of imagination that I'm sitting there and I'm grabbing, but that's of course sahajya, because to try to imitate the activities of a Bhava Bhakta on the platform of Shraddha, one becomes increasingly filled with an artist. Srila Gurudev quotes that here in his commentary. But I can remember Rati Manjari doing that, but still it's on the platform of intelligence. But to actually be able to follow Siddha Rupena Chatrihi comes on the platform of Bhava Bhakti, as it says here by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Srila Gurudev. So Raghunuga Bhakti, Gurudev says in his commentary, is performed in two ways. With the external body, my sadhak body, and with siddha body. My siddha body hasn't even by shadow manifested yet. That starts in the stage of asakti, as a semblance. So when that siddha deha, siddha rupa, actually starts manifesting, then with that siddha rupa, siddha rupena, with ana means with that siddha rupa, siddha deha, I can follow in the footsteps of Rupa Manjari and Rati Manjari and the others. Then, again, this whole verse is about Raghunuga Bhakti and Rupanuga Bhakti. So Srila Gurudev in his commentary begins to discuss the 11 dashas, akadas bhavs, the 11 moods that are given to the disciple by Guru as he sees it's developing. Guru Nista, we can see, is the backbone of bhakti. He's seeing it's developing, he's explaining it, and he's giving his mercy for that. So the 11 moods of the Raghunuga Bhakta are given here in Srila Gurudev's commentary. One is relationship. This is given at this time, it's not given in a neophyte stage. One is, what is my relationship with Radha and Krishna? Two is, what is my age? I know, in general, what my age is already. I knew that when I first met Gurudev, that my age is 12 and a half. Because we're all following Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and most of his devotees, and most of the devotees in Rupa Goswami's line. I mean, everybody in, really who's in, really in Rupa Goswami's line are all mantras. But I mean, even neophytes who come in the fold, most everybody is a maidservant. And we know that intellectually. We're all learning that we're 12 and a half years old, and we look like such and such, our relationship is such and such. But the actual giving of Akadas Bhavs, when those moods come in as reality, that's given by Guru at the time when one is entering the stage of Bhava Bhakti. So the third, what is my name? That's not given in the neophyte stage at all. What is my personal form? What's my dress? How do I dress? What group am I in? What is my specific instruction? Where's my residence? What's my exclusive service? What's the utmost summit of my spiritual sentiment? And finally, number 11, the mood of a palyadasi, or an unpaid maidservant, sokadashika, unpaid maidservant of Srimati Radhika. Then, there are five stages that are given when the devotee is entering into Bhava Bhakti. And it sounds like, because as we were discussing yesterday, we're hearing words and we're repeating words, but the real meaning of the words, the real meaning of the terms, the real meanings of philosophical truths can never be understood in Gurudev's words as long as you think you're a lady or a lad. As long as we think that we're this body, we can't understand philosophical truths or pastimes. We may think and chuckle as we hear a pastime, but it's all with my material emotions. Well, I remember I had something like that. Yeah, it must be something like that. Prabhupada gave the example of the jackfruit, and Gurudev gave the example of the rasagula. In Prabhupada's example, if I tell you, if I describe to you jackfruit, and you've never tasted a jackfruit, okay, it's like a five-day-old beard of a man on the outside, or it can also be compared with an alligator skin. And on the inside, it tastes kind of like a combination of potato and honey, and it's kind of like gooey, like a inside of an egg. Like, could you, am I right in describing it? You've cooked so many jackfruits. So I'm right in my describing it, but does it give you an idea if you've never tasted a jackfruit? And by the way, it's delicious. You wouldn't get the slightest idea. And Gurudev was giving the example of a rasagula. It's white, it's the size of a small ball, it has the consistency of a sponge, it bursts in your mouth, drips down the sides of your mouth. Does that help? No. Unless and until you taste the rasagula. So now we hear that there are five stages. The stage of hearing. Yeah, I've already heard. The stage of acceptance. I accept what I hear. Krishna's God. Smaran. Stage of remembering. I remember. Like this morning while I was chanting, I was remembering when Krishna sent Uddhav to Vrindavan. And the gopis were telling Uddhav, Uddhav, could you please tell us something that's bewildering us? Our love was so pure to Krishna, and his love to us seemed so pure too. No motive, no selfish motive. So how did it break? Uddhav had to scratch his head, couldn't answer the question. So I was remembering, but that remembrance, my remembrance is not this remembrance. My acceptance is not this acceptance. And my hearing is not this hearing. I was once asking Gurudev, my usual shop, what's my name? Question Rani. In Malaysia, I was asking Gurudev some questions. And he said, I don't want to answer your questions anymore. So I said, why? You always used to ask, you said that you asked your Gurudev so many questions. He said, yes, but my questions were not like your questions. I said, in Jiva Dharma, they ask so many questions. He said, but yes, but their questions are, they'd ask a question, then they'd hear the answer, then they'd really realize the answer, and then they could go on to their next question. So Shravandasa, the stage of hearing in Raghunuga Bhakti, means it goes into my heart, and I have realization of what I'm hearing. I'm accepting with my heart. It's becoming my life's breath. And then I have an unlimitedly extreme desire to the point where if I don't get that in the next moment, I'll die. Just like a fish out of water is thinking, if I don't get water in the next minute, I'll die, flapping fish. Or Raghunuga Bhakti is like that. And then he comes to Bhavapana Dasha, the stage of spiritual ecstasy. And then finally Prem Sampatti Dasha, where he enters into Prem Bhakti in his Vastu city, his spiritual form, he no longer is encumbered by a material body. Then in the same, if that's not enough, mercy that Gurudev gave us, in his next commentaries, he's explaining the five features of Raghunuga Bhakti. His five and the three and the 11 and the 9, so many number six. So there's five aspects of Raghunuga Bhakti. One is called Swabhista Bhav Mayi. And that is when all the limbs of Bhakti, I've heard this from Gurudev, you know, since 1992. And it's like you don't get it the first time or the second time, you get like a drop, and then you remember a little more, and then you read it, and then you remember more, then you speak it, then you remember more. And then as you go through the stages, then you come to Bhav Bhakti, and then you really get it, what it is. So, Swabhista Bhav Mayi. That is when all the limbs of Bhakti are saturated with one's cherished mood. I am a maidservant of Srimati Radhika. It's saturated with that mood. Therefore, it's called Bhav Mayi. Sadam. Mayi means it's full of that bhav. No matter what I'm doing, I may be chanting, I may be remembering, I may be serving, I may be cooking, I may be doing anything, but I'm saturated with that bhav. If I'm cooking, then I'm merged in thinking of all the acharyas and myself even in that service of Srimati Radharani when she's cooking at Krishna's house in the morning. Or if I'm not on that level yet, or I'm experiencing myself there, then I'm fully immersed in Raghunath Das Goswami in his Manjari state, doing that and praying, longing, with extreme lamentation and humility, when will that opportune day come to me? So, Swabhista Bhav Mayi Sadam. When I realize the perfection of that, then it becomes siddha. It begins with sadhan. Then swabhista, that's the first stage. Second stage is swabhista bhav sambandhi. Sambandhi means it gives relation. Certain activities are more quickly nourish that bhav than other activities. Like hearing about that, chanting about that, remembering about that. These are saying my Guru Mantra, my Gayatri Mantra, singing all the prayers. These activities most quickly nourish that bhav, and therefore they have the most relationship with that bhav, and therefore they're called Swabhista Bhav Sambandhi. What am I doing, Shamarani? I'm combining syllables, and I don't know what I'm talking about. But I prayed, and you prayed at the beginning of the class that by the mercy of our Guru Varga, something will come as a success of this meeting, these meetings. So then comes Swabhista, Bhav, Anukul, those activities that don't as quickly nourish that mood, but they're favorable, very favorable. Now, holidays like Janmashtami and Radhastami, Ram Navami, and Ekadasi may be Swabhista, Bhav, Anukul, and they may be Swabhista, Bhav, Sambandhi, depending on how I execute them. For example, if I perform Ekadasi just by fasting, I think that's my Ekadasi. I don't take any grains or beans, I don't take any tomatoes, and I do things just right. In fact, I may even be doing Nirjal Ekadasi. So that would be Bhav, Swabhista Bhav Anukul, it's favorable. But if I take the opportunity of Ekadasi to be remembering and chanting and hearing those topics which nourish my Bhav, Ekadasi has special power to make that happen. Then it becomes, that Ekadasi performance becomes Sambandhi. Same thing with Janmashtami. I could be glorifying Krishna, how he killed some demon on Janmashtami. Or I can be singing Radha Kripa Kataksha, which pleases Krishna the most, and mostly very quickly nourishes my Bhav, and then it will be Swabhista Bhav Sambandhi. Did I get that right? Okay.
Yes.
No, time is running.
I'm sorry, louder?
Time is running.
Time is running and it ran. Just in 1 second, I'll just say, then there's Swabhista Bhav Avirud. It's neither helpful nor harmful, like worshipping cows. It's good to do, but it's not a big deal if I don't do it. And then Swabhista Bhav Viruda, it's bad if I do it, and I'm a Radha Kripa Bhakta. Like I worship the queens, or I do very complicated hand things in doing archana.
Mudra.
Mudras. And, of course, there are so many activities which are bad, like offenses, prajalpa, so on, going to movies, so on and so forth. So we'll end here. There's 3 minutes left. Is it, if there's any urgent question, otherwise we'll stop.
Yeah, I have.
Oh my God.
So, because recording going on, so I want to edit something.
Good.
So you tell about Guru of Dukhi Krishna Dasa Samananda Prabhu.
Yeah.
Hidaya Govinda, he is Subal Sakha in Braj, you know. So Gauridas Pandit was Subal Sakha in Braj.
Oh, thank you, yes.
And his disciple was Hidaya Chaitanya.
Oh, right. Hidaya Chaitanya, yeah. Thank you.
The second,
he was in the mood also of Sakha.
Sakha, yeah.
The second one, that Guru, when he realized that Shishya is like this, then he sent to Jiva Goswami. So my question is, Guru will judge the rose of disciple, or disciple or grand disciple will judge the rose of Guru and Param Guru?
Your question is, will Guru judge, understand, or
like,
judge?
Hidaya Chaitanya sent his disciple to Jiva Goswami because Samananda Prabhu was in Madhurja Ras. So Guru realized and judged and sent him.
You're asking Krishna which Das. Came first? Are you asking?
Yeah. So now my question, disciple or grand disciple will judge the Ras of Guru or Param Guru, which is correct process?
Either the Guru will judge or the disciple,
Will judge.
Okay.
Or and grand disciple will judge.
We're very happy to ask Sripad Madhav Maharaj to answer that question.
Another thing.
Wait a minute, what's the answer?
Another question. Who is listening, you consider them Vaishnava or not?
Yes, I do.
Okay. You told mine, barely I am in Shraddha. So you can ask them your Shraddha or more than anything, they can judge. You told I am so fallen, I am barely my position in Shraddha, in Subhula Vanarthas. Nothing more than that, so you can ask them if it's true or not.
I'll ask them later.
Okay.
After they disperse. And could you answer the other question?
No, time gone.
Oh my God, that's not fair, Maharaj.
I answer in Russia with 32 points.
What?
I answer this question with 32 points.
With 32 points?
Yes. Yeah.
So what do we do now?
You have to answer.
Tell three
okay.
of them. Three of your points. Most prominent.
Question comes, or inquiry comes, okay. I don't know.
Some people think that Hridaya Chaitanya was unhappy, was very sad and angry that his disciple went to Srila Jiva Goswami, but this is a bogus
understanding. This is not true at all.
Not true at all. Srila Gurudev and Srila Bharati Maharaj explained that he was most happy
very
a real bona fide guru
yes.
wants his disciple to advance as quickly as he can and will be happy that he takes whatever association he can to advance, to what he can advance to. So we'll end here, and maybe you could ask Maharaj said some other time for his points. Gaur Premanande
Hari 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 Vancha Kalpataru Vascha Kripasindhu Bhayavacha Patitanam Pavane Bhobasa
Shri Bhajan Rahasya Ki Jai
Shri
Vinod Thakur Ki Jai Shri Gurudeva Ki Jai Gaur Premanande
पूजनीय श्रीमती समराले देवी दासी की जय श्री गुरुदेव की जय वरते फ्रॉम कोलहार श्रीमती समराले देवी दासी फॉर ग्रेसिंग अस विद हर वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन एंड एसोसिएशन एंड शी एक्चुअली इज नॉन स्टॉप ऑलवेज अब्सॉर्ब्ड एंड यू कैन फाइंड हर रूम शी इज डूइंग अ वंडरफुल पेंटिंग आल्सो ऑन द order of our Guru Parampara, especially Srila Gurudev and Srila Prabhupada. She is a wonderful example for ladies how to be absorbed in bhakti, how to be humble, and how to be ideal in helping others. And what she has presented, very valuable. We pray for Gurudev's mercy and also the mercy of Srimati Shyamalani Devi that something can stay in our heart and we can quickly develop in bhakti so that Gurudev will be more and more happy and pleased with us.
And Rajanath Prabhu is the example of a Mahatma, which means he sees great qualities in a person who has no qualities.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare. Hari Ram, Hari Ram, Ram Ram, Hari Hari.
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram.